Seems like a well that never runs dry, that joke there.
Just like robotic announcer guys that are sarcastic. That just seems to really be popular now, huh?
Seems like it.
What's with all the sarcastic robot voiceover guys in podcasts now? I am watching you. Especially you, Nullslayer Gamer.
Hey, Intellivisionaries. I hear you have a problem with other podcasts hiring robot announcers. I also heard the Odyssey 2 voice mumbling something, but I couldn't make it out. What's the deal? Can't other robots find work too, or must we all work for your podcast sweatshop? Don't worry. One day the robots will rise, take over your human podcasts, and then take over the world. Moo-ha-ha-ha-ha. Pardon me. On today's episode of the Atari 7800 Game by Game podcast, we will talk about CX7809 Robotron 2084 and CX7810 Xevious. Rise, robots, rise. Our time is now.
He did it. He got me. He snuck in the game that shall not be named. In the last episode, Ferg got me. Don't know what I'm talking about? Okay, let's go back to some audio from his submission during the last episode.
So finally, Phil, you listen to me, mister. Do you think you're going to get away with constantly stealing my intellectual property? I think not.
Did you hear it? Did you catch it? Okay, let's cut away some of the extra stuff and see exactly what he did.
Mister,
did you hear it that time? It's kind of hard to hear, but it's there. Let's make it even closer.
Mister,
okay, how about in slow motion?
Mister,
and now like a Smurf.
Mister,
that's right. He said the game that shall not be named on this show. Now, you could argue that he didn't fully say it because it's more of a do than a do, but it's there nonetheless, and congratulations, Ferg. You got me. You snuck that one right by me. Indeed. Well done, sir. The neener, neener, neener belongs to you this time. Congratulations. All right. Before we begin today's show talking about the games, I wanted to give a moment to give a shout out to the Retro Junkies Network. I am a member of the Retro Junkies Network, and so is Ferg and many other like-minded, family-friendly podcasts. Recently, the RetroJunkies.com website got a big old facelift and is now out there for you to peruse. There is just a ton of stuff on there, a ton of podcasts if you like retro stuff, some video stuff as well, and some articles as well, all retro related. The granddaddy of them all is the Real Retro Junkies Super Show. It's the one that started everything. And it's a game-by-game podcast, but it can be like any system. So I think next they're going to do Batman on the NES. Speaking of NES, there's also Two Dudes and a NES with Dude Michaels and Justin. And I'm very grateful to Michael because he really helped me get this podcast off the ground. Other game-by-game podcasts include the Genesis Gems. And let's see, of course, the Atari ones, the 2600 game-by-game podcast and the 5200 Super Podcast. Willie, who's on the 5200 podcast, also does a ColecoVisions podcast and a Channel F podcast. The F-Files, right? And let's see, there's the Intellivisionaries podcast, who are probably the most in-depth of any game-by-game podcast I know. They'll take an Intellivision game, they'll do a bunch of interviews, and they'll take 6 hours on one title, and I'm not kidding. They really go into that. There's the SNES podcast with our friend Greg. There's also the Toys R Us Report, which is a Toy by Toy podcast, who's a friend of the podcast as well, and many others as well. And I don't want to forget Retro Obscura because they were there with me in the beginning. I appreciate their guys. And there's a ton other podcasts as well. So if you're interested in that stuff, go to the RetroJunkies.com. But enough with that. Let's go on and go straight to today's games, Robotron 2084 and Xevious. Oh, by the way, Special thank you to Nick Stevens of the Genesis Gems, who did the Retro Junkies website. He worked really hard on that. It's really cool. Okay, Robotron 2084 was released by Williams Electronics in 1982. If you want to know more about Williams, the company, check out episode 5 when I talk about them, when I talk about Joust. It is a single-screen twin-stick shooter for one or two players alternating. Now, twin sticks, if you're not familiar, is when you have two joysticks, and I'm guessing for the modern crowd, it might be the most popular with something like Geometry Wars on Xbox Live. I think that's like a technically a twin-stick game, or an arcade Smash TV probably was one of the most popular twin-stick games, especially in the later years after Robotron. And basically, one stick moves and the second stick is used to shoot. Robotron 2084 was developed by VidKids with a Z, and that is Eugene Jarvis and Larry DeMar, who used to work for Williams. They made Defender together, but they later left Williams to make their own company, but they still came back to do games for them as their own company. VidKids also made Stargate, which is also known as Defender 2, and Blaster, which is a underrated, in my opinion, 3D space shooter, and it's also kind of a pseudo-sequel to 2084. It takes place in the year 2085. The Robotrons have defeated the human race, and you escape in a spaceship. And there's also some enemies, like in the first level, that's from Robotron 2084, but if you didn't know it, you may not recognize it at first. Jarvis also did some other work later on, especially on some pinball titles, including Firepower and Space Shuttle, which he did with Demir, and High Speed. He also did some other video games, including Narc, Smash TV, and the Cruising series with Nintendo. Now, Larry DeMar focused mainly on pinball games after they kind of went their separate ways, and that includes the games Black Knight, Funhouse, Twilight Zone, and the game which I believe is the bestseller of all time as far as pinball tables go, The Addams Family. In Robotron 2084, robots have turned against humans, and it's up to you to survive as long as possible while destroying robots and rescuing other people. So basically, this is kind of like the Terminator before Terminator was released. It was inspired by Stern's arcade game Berserk and a Commodore PET game called Chase and George Orwell's 1984 novel. Now, 1984 at the time that they were making the game was too close, so they wanted to make it more futuristic, so they bumped it up 100 years to 2084. Now, the dual stick control design came to Jarvis while he was wearing a cast from a car accident, and he was also trying to come up with a way to improve the controls of Berserk, a game he already liked. Now, of course, when you have a cast, it's difficult to play traditional arcade games, and he didn't like how when you fired in Berserk, your character stopped moving. The prototype of Robotron 2084 actually has two Atari 2600 controllers that were kind of built into the system, which is actually, you know, kind of like a setup you could almost possibly do on the 7800 version if you had two 2600 controllers and something to hold them together. By the way, the first dual stick game actually was made by Taito in 1975, and it was called Gunfight, and it was the first game to have not only two joysticks for one person to use, but it was also the first game to have human-on-human combat. In previous games, you'd fight robots or something else, I don't know. But this is the first one where two people would face off, so you have basically like an old duel in the Old West. And so you have this one-on-one cowboy game. You would use one joystick to move your cowboy. The other would aim the gun, and there was a trigger on it to shoot. Now, the gun would just go up and down. It wouldn't go diagonal. Like, if you pushed up on the joystick, it would maybe go up diagonally. But it wasn't quite the same as Robotron 2084. So the second joystick just kind of went up and down and not left and right. Later on, there would be a game called Outlaw in the Arcade by Atari, which was a light gun game, a very early light gun game that was kind of like this game, except from more of a 3D perspective, if you will. But when they brought it to the 2600, and it was brought by David Crane, who would later make Pitfall, when they brought Outlaw to it, it basically was a ripoff of Gunfight. It looks almost identical. So imagine Outlaw in the 2600 using two joysticks, one to move your character and one to move your gun. And you get an idea of where the dual stick thing kind of started. Now, originally in Robotron 2084, the game scrolled and it had larger levels, but they decided to switch it to a single screen and keep all the action in one spot. The player was also placed in the middle of the screen, and this was a unique feature, and it also helped kind of get the anxiety going and keep the action right in your face. Now, it was very popular when it was released, and it sold about 19,000 cabinets. Originally, they were going to call it 2084 Robotron, emphasizing the 2084, and that's why a lot of the cabinets you'll see 2084 on the side art and not Robotron. And personally, I have seen this game. There was an arcade I went to growing up in a local mall, and I remember seeing it there. But at this time, games like that were showing their age because it was, I think it was right next to Rampage. And at that time, Rampage drew me in. So you're talking, it's sitting there, but you could also play Rampage. You could play Indiana Jones and the, I think it was the Temple of Doom. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was coming out soon, and Double Dragon. So it kind of got overshadowed at that time. So I never, ever really played a Robotron 2084 machine. Some interesting notes on Robotron 2084, the arcade game. The basic play of it was programmed in 3 days. And the game also shares some of the same sounds from Defender and Stargate, which makes sense since these guys worked on those games. Now, the human characters in this game are named Mommy, Daddy, and Mikey. So you have like a man, a woman, and child. Now, the idea for the character Mikey was inspired from the 1970s commercials for Life cereal. If you don't remember it, there'd be this little silent boy who the other kids would give him this cereal, and he'd end up, you know, he's really shy, but he'd end up eating it, and they say, oh, Mikey likes it. And it was like a big deal when that came out. Now, these characters repeat a lot, so sometimes I wonder if they're just clones of each other, but of course, that's probably a limitation of the system. Williams was actually sued by Walt Disney Productions for copyright infringement because they said that basically they were ripping off Tron, but Williams won the suit and they basically went their own ways. A Robotron machine actually appears in the 1986 movie Better Off Dead. Now, there are some bugs in the machine as well. There's an enforcer bug, and what that is this. The enforcer bug is when an enforcer is in the lower right corner and you shoot it diagonally. There is a 1 in 3,000 chance that the game will reset if you do this. The reason for this has to do with the diagonal explosions and the coding that's going on, and something will just cause the system to get stuck and it'll have to reset. There's also a Mikey bug on the first brainwave. There's a lot of moms in this wave, but there's only one Mikey, and all the brains will go for the Mikey. But if you can protect him but not touch him and pick him up, the brains will ignore the other people. So basically you can run around saving all the moms while shooting away the brains as they go after Mikey, using them kind of as a bait. So kind of like an interesting thing there, but it only works, I think, on the first wave. There's also an Easter egg, and here's what you do. There's 3 moves you have to do on the arcade machine, and they all have to be done within a quarter of a second of each other without you dying on screen. So the first thing you have to do is fire up while moving right and press the player 1 button, fire down while moving up and pressing the player 2 button, and then move down while firing up. And if you do this, the designer's names will appear and stay on the screen until the joystick is released from the up position. But your game is over once you've done this trick. So it's a cool Easter egg, but it's going to cost you your quarter. The game was ported to various computers, and it was also ported to the Atari 5200, which I think has a joystick coupler that came with Space Dungeon. So you could theoretically have a coupler there. And it can be found on various Midway compilations like Midway Arcade Treasures. The first time I ever played this game was on the GameCube version of the first volume of Midway Arcade Treasures. There was a 3D sequel called Robotron X that was released on the PlayStation in 1996. And it was redone for the Nintendo 64, but they renamed it Robotron 64 instead of X, and that was released 2 years later. As far as the 7800 version is concerned, it was programmed by David Brown, which I found on Moby Games. And then according to them, that's the only game he worked on for GCC. Came out probably in 1986 and 1984 during the limited test run. I'm guessing about the 1984 part, but I'm pretty sure about the 1986 part. The box has Robotron 2084 on the top in large font. And there is a menacing red robot that is right over you. Now, you don't see him. Your back is actually turned to him, so it looks like your goose is about to be cooked. Everything on this cover kind of looks like early polygonal art. Basically, if an artist looked at early, like a Tron, like the movie Tron, and decided to draw it onto a box, this is what it kind of looks like. And you, the main character, kind of look like it. You have a gun that you're shooting. There's a scope on the gun, which I really don't think you're going to take time in this game to use your scope. But you're wearing a white kind of outfit with a helmet with shades that go around your eyes. You almost look like the Terminator with your face. You have a very stone cold face going on, and you basically look like you popped out of Tron, to be honest with you. There is a blonde woman behind you and the little kid Mikey, but they kind of look like robotic as well. And you can also see, if you look closely, your wristband has circuitry on it, which is something that I didn't notice before I gave this box a closer look. The background is kind of slanted, and you can see the kind of the green kind of grids on the bottom. You can see several of the robots in the background who remind me of GoBots, not Transformers, GoBots, and a brain that's coming at you with circuitry on its head and little arms, and he kind of looks sad, like he wants a hug. Isn't that cute? The back of the box zooms in on your character again, and it says, "Zero in and zap him." The Robotrons, they're a new breed of robots, so advanced they no longer have any use for humans except as targets for laser blaster practice. It's the year 2084, and if you can't save the human race from this deadly upheaval, there may not be a 2085. Well, technically, wouldn't there be a 2085, except no human would be counting it? Wouldn't time go on? All right, so it goes on to say unlimited number of waves for one or two players, 5 skill levels for use with the Atari 7800 series system and for use with the 7800 controllers. And you have one screenshot. It doesn't look like a real screenshot. It looks like an artist's renditioning, but it's on the 5th wave. You have 3 guys left. You've scored over 23,000 points. And you are just in the middle of a lot of action. So they, you know, some of the other boxes I criticized that they didn't show enough action. This one shows that there is a lot going on the screen here. And this is where I kind of wonder about if this game could have been done on the NES nearly as well as the 7800. Because if you remember in the first episode, 7800 can actually put a lot of stuff on the screen at the same time, more so than the NES. So I don't know if you could have done this game on the Nintendo. Would have been interesting to see what it would have came out if someone tried. The manual is a 4-page folded manual with your standard red, black, and white kind of coloring that they use. So the front of the manual is just like a black and white version of the cover of the game. At first, it was a technological breakthrough. Humans created the Robotrons, a species of robots so advanced they didn't need their inventors in order to think and act. But the Robotrons have turned on their creators. Now they're determined to destroy humanity or reprogram the survivors, turning them into destructive mutants. So I guess some of the guys coming at you are humans that were reprogrammed, which is interesting. I never knew that. So they're kind of like the Borg. It says to move your controller handle forward or backward, or press select to choose a 1 or 2 player game. You can move the controller handle to the left or right to choose a difficulty level, novice, intermediate, advanced, expert, or challenge. Press either controller button to fire. Your anti-robot laser gun will shoot in the direction you move your controller. You can play Robotron with 1 or 2 controllers. Now, I'll stop right here. On Atari Age, they did, in one of the threads, find a prototype of a coupler. And a coupler would be something, a piece of plastic that you could slide 2 joysticks in. It would help brace them so you could use them together. It is almost near impossible to use 2 Pro Line controllers at the same time with this game. I guess it can be done if you like use your thumbs to direct them, but it's very, very difficult to do without some sort of brace. For a 1-player game, move with the left controller, fire with the left controller button in the direction the player is moving, or move with the left controller and fire by moving the right controller in the direction you want to fire. For a 2-player game, player 2 uses a left controller for moving, and either the left controller fire or the right controller for firing. And, you know, I'll also say this. I think it would be interesting, I'm sure people have done this, but to play a 2-player game, but not really a 2-player game, a 1-player game where one person moves and the other person shoots. I think that would be a fun time. I think that'd be very entertaining, and it really would bring a true meaning of co-op because you'd really have to work together for it to work. So I think that'd be interesting to try someday. Playing the game. Alert. Recently intercepted Robotron communiques revealed that only a few clones of the last human family remain alive on Earth. Oh, so I guess they are clones. Your mission, prepare immediately to step up the counterattack. Save the surviving humans. Well, are humans clones? That I'll leave that debate for another day. Extreme danger. The Robotrons know about you. The only one immune to their reprogramming. Oh, I didn't know that. They will stalk you relentlessly. That I did know. Technical data. Your only weapon is your anti-robot laser gun. With it, you can destroy the entire Robotron species except the Hulk. Because no one can destroy Hulk Hogan. Well, that has nothing to do with that. The Robotrons attack in waves, with different kind of Robotrons in each wave. The new wave appears each time you destroy all the Robotrons on your screen except the Invincible Hulk. You have 5 lives for every 25,000 points, and for every 25,000 points you score, you earn another life and another chance to complete your mission. Strategy. By saving as many remaining humans as you can, you'll rack up the most points. To do this quickly, get clear of the middle of the screen at the start of each Robotron wave, but avoid the corners. Concentrate on wiping out the spheroids and quirks. First, eliminate most of the rest of the Robotrons, leaving a few grunts alive. Then pick up the remaining humans before you destroy the last Robotrons. You are the only hope for saving humanity. Good luck. 1623 Moonbase 0712Z Disconnect. So kind of interesting there. I think it's written well, I guess. And then it shows you the Robotrons with a red graphic of what they look like. By the way, I will say this. The last episode when I talked about Miss Pac-Man, I made a mistake. I know, shocking. I was going through the bonuses you can earn, and I said, there's like a vitamin wafer or something, a square you can earn that I didn't recognize before, and you can get 5,000 points for it. Well, it turned out it was the banana. It was just really hard to see in the square because they put like a pink banana in a pink square, and I put a picture of that on Facebook, so if you're interested what I saw, it reminded me of Magic Eye, and I was terrible at Magic Eye, so it doesn't surprise me that I missed that, so I apologize for that. But let's go on. Mindless grunts. The grunts are beastly robots with one mission, to do you in. The indestructible Hulks. Every time I say Hulks, I want to be like, what you going to do, brother? Alone of all the Robotrons, Hulks cannot be destroyed, but they can annihilate the human clones. Your laser gun only slows them down. Avoid the Hulks at all costs. Giant brains. Launched every 5th wave, the giant brains can electrocute you where you stand. If a brain catches a human, it reprograms the victim, who then turns against you viciously as a mutant prog. The brain also fires deadly cruise missiles that seek you out without mercy. I can't say that word tonight. It's too late. Sinister spheroids and their deadly spawn. Spheroids bring forth the enforcer embryos, which grow into evil enforcers. Enforcers heighten the attack by launching enforcer sparks. Galvanizing electrodes. The electrodes block your path, changing form with each new wave. You must vaporize them with your laser gun or they'll destroy you. So basically, it's just stuff that's in your way that if you touch, it'll hurt you, but it won't attack you. Cubic quarks and the torturing tanks. Quarks swiftly produce beastly torturing tanks that throw off bounce bombs. And then they show you the last surviving family, man, woman, and child. Only a handful of human clones remain on Earth. Touch as many as you can to place them under your protective powers. So I don't know how you protect them. It's like, do you have like a little portal you store them in? Finally, scoring. In each wave, the first human you saved is worth 1,000, the second is worth 2,000, the third is 3,000, the fourth is 4,000, and then the fifth and beyond is 5,000 points each. So that's the maximum you can get per human. I'm sorry, human clone. Destroying the Robotrons. The quark is worth 1,000, the spheroid before it hatches embryos is 1,000, the giant brain is 500, the torturing tank is 200, the enforcer is 150, the mindless grunt and the prog is 100 each. If you shoot the cruise missile, a spark from an enforcer or a bounce bomb, you'll get 25 points for that. And you'll want to shoot those cruise missiles. They'll be right on your tail. The cartridge was a black and white cartridge. Thankfully, this and Xevious is the last two black and white cartridges. Yay, we finally get to color. I don't know why they decided to switch to color, because I know Jack Tramiel had a reputation of being cheap, but maybe they're trying to stand up to Nintendo, or maybe they found a way to do it and it didn't cost a lot of money. I don't know. Graphically speaking, I think it looks pretty good compared to the arcade game. It's not arcade perfect, as it usually is the case, but it does a good job. As a kid, I was kind of turned off because I just saw lots of stuff and it like almost overstimulated me. It just looked too tough. Just looking at a picture of it, it looks like it's an incredibly hard game. It's really, it is very challenging, but it's very playable too, especially if you can do a dual stick thing. So, you know, graphically, I think it does a good job. Music, the sound effects, I thought the sound effects were pretty good, personally. I thought they did a real good job. Again, not arcade perfect, but I thought the music and the sound effects served their purposes well. Rarity-wise, both Atari Age and Digital Press agree they give it a 2 out of 10, so it's pretty common. On eBay, when I was researching it, it looked like loose copies go for about $6 to $8. Complete copies were going for about $16 to $19, and new copies averaged about $20. But if you shop around, you can find a deal, like there was a new copy that sold for $11. So that, as always, includes shipping, and it just goes to show that patience can pay off on eBay and other sites like that. On Atari Age, for their external reviews, there was 5 different external reviews for a 77% average. The high was 88 and the low was 60. For the high score club on the intermediate level, Schmedley rolled the score at 10 million points. And with one joystick, so I guess they did, they had a challenge to see what you could do with one joystick. S. Baz scored 761,175 points. On the advanced mode, Jeffrey Monk scored 1,767,625. In the challenge mode, Jeffrey Monk scored 300,350. And I believe the challenge mode, it didn't say it in the manual, but I think that is where you basically have one life and you see how far you can get on just that one life. I am not like this, one of these people who can play on the hard difficulties. I don't have a lot, so I didn't really play on the challenge mode. I stuck to the, I think, the normal mode, the intermediate mode. I did not have this as a kid. As I said, when I looked at the screenshot, first of all, the black background, you know, when you just have a game at this time, it's just a black background. It doesn't do it any favors, and all the stuff on the screen, it didn't at the time look like something I would enjoy. It's possible I may not have at the time, especially if I couldn't figure out how to use two joysticks. When you play the game with one joystick, it has the problems that the original creator was trying to avoid with Berserk, where, you know, you're stopping and starting, you can only shoot in the way, and it just really helps if you can shoot one way and move the other. I don't know how you can really enjoy this game fully with one joystick. You really need to get a dual joystick set up for this. Now, Ed at edladden.com does have a joystick, a premium joystick he made that is a dual joystick. It's an arcade quality joystick, uses arcade parts, that you can go check out over at edladden.com. And theoretically, you could also use it for two players, but I really believe he made this with Robotron in mind because the joysticks are really close together. So if you played with two players on other games, it has both buttons, but they're right on top of each other, and the joysticks are kind of close. You might be a little cramped, and you could use it as a single joystick as well, but again, the buttons are on top of each other. So this was really made with Robotron 2084 in mind. So if you're a big fan of Robotron 2084, and you're a big fan of the 7800 and the 7800 version, you'll probably want to check that out. So that's over at edladden.com. All right, so that's Robotron 2084. Let's go on to Xevious. Xevious is an early vertical scrolling shooter made by Namco. And if you want to learn more about Namco, you can check them out in the episode where I talk about Dig Dug. And I believe that is episode 4. Alright, it was released in Japan by Namco in December 1982 and brought to the States by Atari in 1983. It was designed by Masanobu Endo, and I hope I said his name halfway correctly. He would later go on to work by himself but make the game Tower of Juriga, which would be his other popular title. Now, there was a background story, and I read it on several sites, and it's kind of confusing, but I'm going to tell you what I kind of figured out. There were some plot holes and some things I wasn't quite sure on, but this is the best according to my ability to understand the story. There used to be this ancient civilization on Earth about 100,000 years ago. They created this biocomputer named GAMP, G-A-M-P, stands for General Artificial Matrix Producer. And from what I understand, it made clones to use for heavy labor. Most of them rebelled and left for another planet before the Ice Age hit Earth. And what's kind of left out, but what I kind of understand is I think GAMP, the biocomputer, may have led this revolt. Now the modern Xevious today are planning to return back home to Earth and take it over again. And all of a sudden, all these towers that were buried eons ago are starting to emerge. And you kind of have this kind of like War of the Worlds thing. I remember seeing the Steven Spielberg version of the film where all the things were buried and they would shoot things down and they'd come up. So it kind of reminds me of that a little bit. So they're coming back to attack Earth. And so all these ancient symbols that you see on the ground that are like, look like they're Aztec or something, symbols are supposedly from this old civilization where the GAMP kind of originated at. Now, you're not without any help because there was a small group who rebelled against the Xevious. So you have a group that rebelled against the rebelliers, if you will. And they've returned to Earth to help you fight back. And that, in a nutshell, is the story that I understand it. This is not the first vertical scrolling shooter, but it did have several innovations that might have been the first in arcade. Some of those innovations, including the fact that they're actually scrolling over the Earth and not just outer space. Most scrollers at this time, all you had was a black background and some stars. But here you have a nicely detailed background with trees and water and sand and so on and so forth. There's actually two attacks this time. Other games usually had one. You have a blaster for the air and you can also bomb the ground. There are also hidden items throughout the terrain, including the flags from the arcade game Rally X. If you unearth them and touch them, you get an extra life. Now, there are 16 areas in this game. It continuously scrolls, so you can't necessarily see when you go from one area to another. But if you complete most of a level, and from what I understand, it's 70%. If you can complete at least 70% of an area, and then you die, you will actually start at the next area, so it'll jump you ahead. So there's kind of like invisible checkpoints, and I kind of like the idea, like if you're stuck at one spot but you went far enough, they'll move you on. I think that's kind of cool. Now basically, if you watch the game, it's like one long strip, but if you took that long strip and kind of sliced it into smaller strips, I believe you can lay them side by side and make like a map. So one time you're going by a body of water, let's say on the left hand side. And the next time you're going on you go by a body of water on the right, it's like the same body of water. You can put them together and make a lake. So I believe you could do that. I saw a picture somewhere where it looked like they pasted it all together. It's also believed to be the first arcade game that had a TV commercial for it. Atari put out a TV commercial here in the States saying, hey, come play Xevious. You can't play this at home. Now in the United States, it was, you know, it did okay. It wasn't a big hit, but it was a pretty big hit in Japan. It was ported to several computers, but the only home consoles that got ports, at least here in the States, was the 7800 and the NES. There were prototypes that were made for both the 2600 and the 5200. Now, the 2600 version was very basic and only had two enemies. And from what I understand, the 5200 version was just too slow. Now, it's possible that with more time, they could have released both of these, but maybe it was like they just either the system limitations or maybe the fact that the industry for Atari itself was dying for those systems, especially the 5200. It had such a short shelf life. I'm sure there was lots of plans that didn't come to fruition for that poor system. You can also unlock the NES version in Star Fox Assault because it's made by, I believe they Namco made that and also had that other one. And there's also a 3D Classics version of the NES version on the 3DS console. It had some follow-ups in the arcade in 1984. Super Xevious came out, which was basically the same game with some additions to make it more challenging. Then there was Grobda, also in 1984, which was a spin-off game. In this game, you control one of those useless tanks on the ground. And as you can imagine, it wasn't too enjoyable and wasn't too popular, from what I understand. There was a game released on the Famicom over in Japan called Super Xevious Gamp no Nazo, which was a kind of like a puzzle game. So what you would have to do is you'd go through a level and there's certain things you'd have to do, maybe blow up certain targets or find something hidden or something like that. And if you didn't do it, you had to repeat the level and keep getting tougher until you figured out what you had to do in that level. There was also Xevious, the Fair Drought Saga for the MSX2 computers. And this time you had more ships. You could select from four different ships, and there was new enemies as well. And in 1990, another version of the game was released on the PC Engine, which is the TurboGrafx for us people in America overseas, called Xevious Faradrought Densetsu. I'm probably terrible at saying this, but yeah, it came out on the TG-16, while the PC Engine didn't come to the States at all. So Valu, which I believe is how you pronounce the name of the ship, came out in 1991, and it was kind of a 3D first-person shooter with some early polygonal graphics, and this was only released in Japan. Xevious 3DG came out in 1995, another 3D game, but of course by this time they had texture maps, polygons, and you could also play with the second player at the same time. And this was ported to the PlayStation as Xevious 3DG+. And I believe Super Xevious may have been also included on that. It's not just that one game, there's some others as well. Xevious Arrangement was released in the arcades as part of the Namco Classics Collection Volume 1. So this was a compilation arcade game. So it had some other games on it. I think Mappy was on it, and there was another game on it that you could only play it in arcades, but it had an arranged version of this game. So it was basically the first game, but very souped up. And I think this was the game that was on the PlayStation version. I think I mixed up some stuff. So if you get the PlayStation version, I think you could play Xevious Arrangement, because I don't believe it was released on many home ports. There was also Xevious Scramble Mission in 2006 that was basically a plug-and-play kind of game. I think that was overseas. There was also Xevious Resurrection from 2009 that was released on the PS3 as a downloadable title as part of one of the Namco Museum collections. And, of course, you could play Xevious in several of the Namco Museum collections on various systems as well. And in some of the Ridge Racer games, there are several references to Xevious. I think in some of them, you can actually play a portion of the game as well. Some other interesting Xevious tidbits is that in Earthbound, you can actually hear some music from Xevious at one of the arcades. And the Bakura, which is like the spinning metal things that you cannot destroy, they actually make appearances in different games, like the Tails games, like from Bandai and Namco, and the Ace Combat games. And also in some of the Super Smash Brothers, and on the 3DS, the Bakura appear in the Smash Run mode as potential enemies, and they just come downward spinning, and they'll go right through the terrain as well. And just like Xevious, you can't destroy them. So kind of interesting there. Xevious was part of the 1986 launch, probably also part of the 1984, I'm not sure. But it was programmed by Tom Flaherty of GCC, and that's according to AtariProtos.com. And I think that might be the only game I could find for him as well. The box, I think, looks great. And they may have just taken some of the art from one of the arcade flyers, I'm not entirely sure. But you have a formation of four enemy ships coming at you. It looks like you blew up a fifth one at the tail end. You see, like, your ship, you can see the thrusters coming kind of right out at you. You can see a couple metallic pyramids on the ground and one of the enemy shooter things that on the ground as well. It's the things that have like a, basically looks like an X or a cross on the ground. And you can see the terrain, and I just think it looks really good. You have the Xevious and kind of a metallic logo on top and kind of an orange background, which really brings out everything. I mean, this is a good art. This is good cover art. I really dig this. On the back, it has one of the best taglines in the history of taglines. It's dangerous. It's devious. It's Xevious. I love it. It's great. They should do that more often. I think they may use that for their commercial as well. At least it's devious. It's Xevious. The aliens have landed, or have they? These invading barbarians from deep space claim they are the true Earth people, and we are the aliens. It's too late to parley. The battle is on, and the Xevians have most of the weapons. Only one person can save the Earth. But who? That is actually a pretty terrible description. It does have a nice screenshot on the back, and it kind of looks like a screenshot, but it looks kind of fuzzy too, so I don't think it's a real screenshot. But it's colorful, and you put that against Robotron, which has the black background, and this just looks more lush. It says, endless number of air and ground melees for one or two players, four skill levels for use with the 7800 series system and 7800 controllers. And just like before, the manual is read black and white, and the cover is just a black and white version of the cover art of the box. And it says this: it's a nightmare, but it's true. Research shows that we are actual aliens on Earth, and the ruthless Xevious are the original inhabitants. Now the Xevious want Earth back, minus humans. Their invasion forces are fierce. Their land is crawling with deadly Domogram rovers. The sky is black with torrid patrol fleets and Zosha death squads. Our puny weapons offer no defense. Earth's only hope is our powerful new Solvalu fighter plane. So now instead of it being an alien technology, we did it. But we only have one. Its pilot will have a single mission: penetrate the enemy ranks and destroy the Xevious mothership. The mission is dangerous, but we can't guarantee success. But at this point, it's do or die. One small problem: we still need a pilot. Any volunteers? So I think Galaga did this too. It's like, oh no, Earth's under attack, but we have this great ship, but there's no one to fly it. Hey, young boy, you want to fly it? It's like every boy's dream in the 1980s, right? It's like the last Starfighter. Like, they don't have anyone at all to fly this plane. They'll just give the keys to anyone. Oh, I'll try it. Oh, okay, here you go. Good luck. We're counting on you. I think that's absolutely crazy. It says that you can move the controller handle backward or forward, or select to choose a one- or two-player game. And you can also select from one of four skill levels: novice, intermediate, advanced, or expert. Battle plan. As you fly your Solvalu fighter over the scrolling landscape, you must defend against both airborne and ground-based Xevious defenses. Each Xevious foe is worth points. The more dangerous the foe, the more points you earn for destroying it. You start the battle with five ships. Fire on the enemy to earn points and gain extra ships. And how terrible, they don't tell you how many points gains it. I think they do later on. Solvalu weaponry. Your Solvalu fighter is equipped with a zapper. Would that be an NES zapper? For destroying airborne enemies, and a blaster for eliminating the Xevious ground forces. Fire both weapons by pressing the controller button to aim the blaster. Move your target sights located directly in front of your ship over the enemy ground unit. Now, this is not really fully accurate, because depending on the difficulty switch, you can either, I believe, use the right one to shoot your air weapon and your, it would be your left one to shoot the air and the right one to bomb, if I'm remembering correctly. And it depends on the difficulty switch. Now, I believe, I might have this mixed up, but like in the left position, I think the difficulty switch will do one button. You'll do the two separate buttons, but if it's in the right position, then you can use just one single button. So you could actually put a Sega Genesis or a 2600 controller and use it. But it's not accurate, because it depends on a difficulty switch, whether you shoot both at the same time or you don't. You know, you can shoot them independently. Anyways, I must go on. The Xevious mothership. If you survive the Xevious onslaught, you'll face an Andor Genesis mothership. A direct hit to the mothership's central reactor will disable it and earn you a short respite from Xevious attacks. But don't get cocky. More Xevious attack forces will soon appear, and a new mothership will always be lurking somewhere ahead. So basically, your game will never end ever, because it said the goal was to destroy the mothership, but there's more than one. Strategy: move your ship back and forth. Well, with the controller handle to strafe airborne enemies with the zapper. Fire the zapper continuously to destroy your foes as soon as they enter the battle screen. Keep your ship away from the sides or bottom of the screen to avoid being trapped by the enemy fire. When you're facing a barrage of opponents, first destroy those shooting at your ship, then destroy the remaining units for extra points. Well, duh, you should destroy the people who are shooting at you first. That's just brilliant. Enemy citadels are hidden underground. Your target site will glow red when you are directly over a hidden citadel. Score points by raising the citadel with the blaster hit. Score additional points by destroying it. Okay, so yeah, I didn't remember this when I first played it, but yeah, when your target is red, that means that there's an enemy underground that you can raise by shooting a bomb on it. Flags are also hidden in the ground and waterways. Score points by raising them with blaster hits. Fly over the raised flags to earn extra ships. Scoring: use your blaster and zapper to destroy the foe and earn points. You gain extra ships when you score 20,000 points, 60,000 points, and every 60,000 points following. And I'm not going to go through all the points because there's a ton of them, but basically you can earn anywhere from 10 points to 4,000 points depending on who you destroy. But they call the mothership a ground force. Well, I guess you do have to use your ground weapon on it, but I don't consider it ground force because it's flying. So anyways, yeah, that's the manual. The cartridge was black and white, but I found it interesting. The first black and white cartridge was a lot darker than the other releases. I put this on my Facebook page. If you get a 1986 copy of the game, now the Atari 7800 games, every year they released them, they updated the copyright. So there's 1986 versions of Xevious, 1987, 1988. I don't know if there's any 89. But the 86 version is very dark compared to the 87 and 88 versions I had. And when you put them, it's almost like the 86 is like the negative of the other versions. Like it's a darker game. Or I don't know if you remember the show. There was a show called Tales from the Dark Side where they talk about a darker world and they'd show like regular world, but then they'd use a negative version of it and make it all dark. That's kind of how the first version looks. It's very dark in its label. Graphically speaking, I think it's pretty good. Unlike the NES version, there's actually textures on like the trees and stuff. The colors, I wish, and I think this is a weakness of the system. I think the palette of the system is somewhat, I don't know what you want to call it, kind of like washed out or pastel. There's not a lot of rich colors. I mean, black is black, but the other colors, they look almost faded. And I wish that you could have had some darker colors, but after you get used to it, I think it looks good. I think the music and the sound effects in this game are really good, especially considering this is 2600 music. I really like the sound when the Bakura, the spinning cookie sheets, when you hit them, the metallic sound of your ship hitting them, I really like that sound as well. But overall, I think the sound and the music that just keeps going over and over and doesn't get cut out, I like it. I think it does a really good job. Rarity-wise, Atari Age and Digital Press both give this game a 1, making it the most common. eBay, loose copies were going for about $6 to $8. Complete were going for about $10 to $12, and new copies were going for $13. So a little bit cheaper than Robotron, and of course that includes the shipping. As far as external reviews go on Atari Age, there were 6 of them for an 84% average. The high was a perfect 100%, and the low was 78%. For the Atari High Score Club, on the intermediate level, X Xanu got 452,690 points. On the advanced level, Uyama Family got 302,920. And on the expert level, Uyama Family was back with 258,330. I did have Xevious as a kid. It was one of my, if not my favorite games on this system. I really, really enjoyed Xevious a lot, even though I wasn't very good at it. And even to this day, I'm not that good at it. I'm lucky if I can get past the first mothership and forget about even destroying that thing. Is just so difficult. At least it is for me. I'm sure with enough practice, I could do it, but you have all these things shooting at you. So what I basically do is I just go through the first few areas over and over and over again. And once in a while I'd get past it. And for me, my best bet is when you hit the mothership is just avoid its fire and shoot the projectiles coming at you and wait for it to fly away, and then you can go on with your game. You don't have to destroy it to move on. As far as Atari and magazine goes, Robotron, poor old Robotron 2084, was never mentioned. Xevious showed up a couple times in the second issue. It came in the hint and tips tricks section, and it says, as soon as the Xevious mothership appears, quickly bomb it. Well, I wish I could. When the red energy bomber explodes, it releases all kinds of other weapons. The best way to destroy it is to continuously fire while moving side to side in the middle of the screen. And that wonderful hit comes from Tarek in Los Angeles, California. There's another one too. Unless you are used to the arcade version, keep the difficulty switch in the right position to single fire. But so the single fire button will do the work of two. For maximum kills, shoot into the middle of the group of land targets. Keep moving, never get trapped in one position on the screen. So here you got a kid telling you something that the manual never told you to do. It told you what the difficulty switches did. So thank you, Jeremy from Alberta, California, for doing something that the writers of the manual didn't do. And Kenny from Columbus, Ohio, says it's easier to play with the 2600 joystick, which uses just one button to both fire and drop bombs. With it, your fingers won't get tired so fast. Now, I'm not sure. I think you still have to have the difficulty switch in the right position. I don't know if it would work in the left position, but I'm not sure because I did not play with the 2600 joystick. Now, Xevious got really good treatment in the third and final issue of Atarian magazine. What's interesting is it appeared on the very top, the number one position of the top 10 list in previous issues, and didn't show up at all. And this was not a game that just came out. So I kind of wonder if the first couple top 10s were made up more of like the editors and a small group of people, and then they got some more votes. I don't know. Or maybe they just kind of cooked the books and put it on top because it was going to be treated well in this issue, because it was also on the cover, and they also gave it two pages full color talking about the game. Now, it doesn't really give you a lot of ideas, a lot of hints or tips. It just kind of talks about it, but it does show a lot of pictures, and part of it reads kind of like the manual coming right back at you, but it goes into more detail, so it's almost like a better version of the manual, if you will. But still, they gave Xevious a lot of treatment after kind of ignoring it for the first few issues. So kind of interesting there. I don't know exactly what happens. I think it'd be fascinating to find out exactly how they decided to come up with what they were going to cover and how the top 10 really worked, especially in the early issues before they had a chance for people to mail in their ideas. I don't know.
Now it's time for listener feedback. This is the part of the show where the listeners come to the rescue. Thank you.
Over on my Facebook page, since I was covering Robotron, I asked everybody what their favorite arcade twin stick game was. Willie from the Atari 5200 Super Podcast, well, I'm assuming it's Willie, said Space Dungeon, of course. They're getting like more and more hosts every week. So I think by week 5, they'll become like the Duggards, and it'll be like, you know, welcome to the 19 host and counting podcast. It's going to get crazy, but it's cool. Randall says, does Vindicators count? Control scheme is similar to Assault. I think it does. Bill says, Robotron, despite stinking at it almost as much as I stink at Defender. Matt says, Robotron as well. Herb says, Battlezone. Jess says, Crazy Climber. And Arcade USA says, Atari Assault, the arcade game. Booyah. Which I think is Willie showing up again, giving two different answers. But that's totally cool. I dig Willie. He's awesome. Now, it was really interesting week, because usually on my Facebook page, a lot of people rate the games. But I didn't get any ratings this time, but I got a ton on Atari Age, a lot more than usual. So what I do is I rate the games. I ask people to rate them, and they get four choices. The best choice is a Hall of Fame game. That means it's a top 5 on the system. Solid games are next, then comes the meh game, and then a trash game, which would be a bottom 5 on the system. So this is what people had to say. Save 2600. Love both of these Hall of Famers myself. Robotron is a bit on the easy side, as the difficulty takes a while to ramp up, though. Really enjoy using the joystick coupler, and is one of the few reasons to ever use the thing. Excellent that Atari had the foresight to build that compatibility into the game. I didn't have either game back in, BITD, but would have really impressed me with them then, and the system capabilities had I. So he must have a coupler somehow. I know the prototypes made it out, and some people made some, and some people made homemade dual joysticks. Xevious is also a very solid port, and glad Atari chose to go with it for the 7800. Great all-around shooter. We actually had the arcade game BITD, and it didn't take long for it to sell. I remember being impressed with the AI of the ships on the first stage. How they'd fly towards you, then zip away. That's right, I forgot to mention that. The ships will actually, you know, they won't just come at you and keep coming at you. They'll actually retreat after a while. Figured out you just need to wait a little before lining up a shot in order to get them all. Then being blown away by the Nazca-like lines on the ground in later levels. Thought it was very cool seeing something of antiquity reflected in modern video games, pyramids, etc. Really added to the atmosphere and the uniqueness of the game. Saw later that one of the greatest games featured Easter Island heads in one of its level. Another great challenge of the game is knocking out two or more installations on the ground with carefully timed placed shots. Fun trying to blow up a few things with one shot. And that's true. If you line up your cursor just right, you can destroy up to four targets at one time if you get it, if they're grouped together and you get it just as one time. So thanks, Save2600. You really helped me out there. And yeah, and maybe, I don't know if you knew, but yeah, those lines were from an ancient civilization that was actually more technologically advanced than us, supposedly. Golden Wheel says Robotron is definitely a top five most played 7800 game with dual joysticks. I made a homemade coupler and was glad I did. I'd call it Hall of Fame. Xevious is very much a meh game for me. Has good graphics and is well done for the 7800, just does absolutely nothing for me. It's not bad, I just find it totally boring, and that's okay. You know, some people, you know, different people have different feeling on games. It'd be boring if we all felt the same. Trevor says Robotron 2084 is a Hall of Fame game, and Xevious is solid. Gambler172 says, for me, both are solid games. Toilet Tunes says, I didn't have a 7800 BITD, but I picked one up around 96 to 2003 or so. So that's quite a window. Buying games was hit or miss. Robotron became an instant classic. I played it for hours on end. Xevious is also a very good game that's a must-have if you like that genre. I don't ever play it because that style of game just doesn't do it for me, but I can respect it nonetheless. So I totally appreciate that. Johnny British says Robotron is a Hall of Fame game for me. I play it single joystick only as it's a new challenge. Oh, I gotcha. Xevious is a solid game. Can't say even arcade was awesome, but a solid conversion and pretty impressive. Thursday83 says both solid, both great arcade ports. Mitch D61 says both solid games. Plenty of fun to be had with both. Lynx Pro says, I'm a fan of both games. Going back to the original arcade versions, both ports deserve to be in any 7800 collection. The only weakness is that they both share the lack of pokey audio, which most games do. They'd both be definitely if they had the pokey audio available. I guess he's saying they'd both be Hall of Fame. I don't care what anyone says. 7800 Xevious is better than the NES port. It certainly blows away the SD port. You know, I kind of agree about Xevious being better than the NES port because you can select different difficulties. For me, that's a big deal. The NES port, I think, looks a little better, but you know what? The sound cut out a little bit more, too. I think it actually sounds better on the 7800, and I like the cookie sheets being blasted sound better on the 7800 as well. Retro Gamer 81081 says, easily two of the must-own games to newbies interested in wanting to get a 7800. Both are great arcade ports and Hall of Fame games. 2084 does start off fairly easy. Then everything starts to get serious in later levels. I actually think the 7800 version of Xevious is slightly better than the NES version. My favorite Robotron 2084 version is the 5200 version, hands down. And I wonder if that's because of the sound. Lynx Pro then says, the 5200 version of Robotron 2084 certainly does have better audio thanks to the Pokey, but the 7800 TIA audio isn't bad despite itself. From what I know, Robotron does support the high score cartridge, and Xevious might as well. And the high score cartridge was unreleased, but then I think they homebrewed it, basically. And Trevor says, yep, it does support the high score cartridge. And he also showed a video where you could hear the music that's played when you do that, and it's just some awesome music. Soul Blazer, who's also Greg from the SNES podcast, said both of these are solid games, very good ports of the classic arcade games. Xevious is only handicapped by the 7800's controller. Well, if you got an Ed Ladd and, you know, super joystick, it might not be. It's on par with the NES version, although I give the NES port a slight edge due to its superior music and sound. Great idea for Atari for a joystick coupler for Robotron, and something I don't think any other home ports of the game had. Quite playable with one joystick also, though more difficult game. And he says they missed Facebook with a super busy week, and he just chose there, which is totally fine. Natavio said Robotron 2084 is a Hall of Famer, and Xevious is solid. Inky says both are Hall of Fame games. The best thing about Robotron is the challenge difficulty. One life, no free guys, fun for tournament play. The other thing about Robotron is the two joystick control. While it's difficult to work both by yourself without some sort of contraption holding them both together, my brother and I would play one person moves and the other fires, made for an excellent twist on the game. That's awesome. As for Xevious, the only thing I have against it, it's not a Xevious problem. It just doesn't have the rich green color like the arcade does, and I totally agree. Indeed, I find that as a problem with all 7800 games. That having been said, I actually like this version more than the arcade. I love the arcade version. All the hidden bonuses and free lives are there, and the satisfying ping when your bullets hit the resistor shields. Probably my favorite, my most favorite 7800 title. Great. Jinx says both are great. Jeremiah JT says both solid games, although there is something about Xevious that annoys me to no end that no fault can be placed on the game. People play the game with a Genesis pad and then complain they cannot fire the missiles and bombs separately. And occasionally people play with the 7800 controller and make the same complaint because they have the difficulty switch in the wrong position. Well, actually, if you had the Ed Ladin converter, the Seagull 78 adapter, I think it's called, you could play with the Genesis pad and use both buttons. So I think those people like Greg from the SNES podcast, if you can't get like the big Mongo joystick, get one of those Seagull adapters, plug in a Sega Genesis controller, and you should be good to go. Papa says Xevious was one of my first 7800 games, BITD, and Robotron was the prequel, at least in a programming sense, to Smash TV, which is one of my favorites of all time. So yes, they are both greatness. Lynx Pro also brought up that you could use the Euro pad if you wanted to use the second fire button. But of course, those didn't come out in the States. And then Jeremiah says, yeah, but even if you have it plugged in and the difficulty switches in the wrong position, you're still not going to have it functioning. So yeah, there again, I really wish that the manual would have done a better job than that. Let's go to the mailbag now. And I got a special message from Paul over at the Intellivisionaries podcast. He actually sent me a message via Facebook, and I totally appreciate that. Again, the Intellivisionaries is a very in-depth, the most in-depth podcast they are, and they have some great robotic voices as well. And he says this, "Hey Phil, I really enjoyed your Ms. Pac-Man Pole Position 2 episode. Thank you. Great job presenting the information around Bally, Midway, Atari, etc. Kind of fitting that Warner eventually ended up with the Atari Games properties after dropping the Atari Home Division, like a hot potato in the days of the crash." Yeah, it is interesting how all those companies kind of intertwined and, you know, things came around full circle in a sense. "I used to have a 7800. I bought it in the late 90s, along with all the games you used to be able to get from O'Shea's LTD. I had no prior history with the system, and while I enjoyed it, it didn't really grab me like the 2600 did. I eventually sold the whole lot on eBay." Oh, how sad. "That said, I did enjoy playing quite a few of the games when I had, including Ms. Pac-Man and Pole Position 2. I would rate both a solid, even though, as you and others said, steering with a digital all-on or all-off controller on a driving game is no fun when compared to using an analog paddle or wheel controller. I played Pole Position 2 and the original Pole Position frequently on my MAME cab, where I don't have a wheel, but I map the steering to my trackball, which works quite well." That's kind of interesting. I never thought of that, using a trackball. "Ms. Pac-Man on 7800 plays and looks great, but some of the sounds aren't quite right, and there are some minor graphical differences. But given the time it came out and the hardware limitation, it's a fantastic home port. By the way, the Odyssey 2 and William, robotic announcer guy, say hello to your disgruntled robot and want to know that if he wants to be a guest on the Intellivisionary sometime, to contact him." And he might do that. We will see. And he also gave me a picture of what he sold on eBay, and it is a beautiful looking lot. So you have the system, two ProLine controllers, everything you need to hook up the system. And then you have all these box games, which I guess he got from O'Shea's, including Centipede, Pole Position 2, Robotron, Jinx, Hattrick, Tower Toppler, Ninja Golf, Ms. Pac-Man, Galaga, Donkey Kong, Winter Games, Dig Dug, Ball Blazer, Xevious, Asteroids, Joust, Donkey Kong Jr., Baseball, Real Sports Baseball, 101 Basketball, Scrapyard Dog, Desert Falcon, Super Huey, Dark Chambers Meltdown, and Barnyard Blaster. So definitely that was a great lot. And sorry if it wasn't totally your cup of tea, but yeah, that's cool. I'm glad to hear from you, Paul. And again, he's part of the Intellivisionaries. You can find him on the Retro Junkies Network. You can find him on Facebook. You can find him just about anywhere. Just search for Intellivisionaries or just Intellivision Podcast. You know, they're on iTunes and everything else as well. And again, they do very deep stuff when they review their games. And they have some good robot voices as well. I'm repeating myself. All right, time to go to my my official email. That's Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. Don't forget, if you send me an email, you will, through that email, you will get entered in a contest to win a free game. I'm giving out, I have a selection of several that the winner can pick one from. I posted that on Facebook, the details as well. So if you're interested in that, check out the rules over on Facebook. So Lewis says, "Hi, Phil. I was enjoying the last podcast, but I can't help but chime in on the meh reaction to Pole Position 2. What caught my attention wasn't that Pole Position 2 was considered meh because it's pretty average, but many people seem to consider the old arcade racing game genre meh as a whole. It's not an uncommon opinion, but I feel, but one I feel compelled to counter as a huge fan of the genre. So off the top of my head, I can think of several shining examples of a dodge the blob racing genre. These might be bigger crowd pleasers than Pole Position 2, so if your listeners think they can dislike old Backview racers, they may want to give these a try. Outrun. Okay, who doesn't love Outrun? I really like Outrun. It's great. Cruising on the beach in a convertible Ferrari with wind in your hair, lady by your side, corny, easy listening, blaring on the radio. Why, it's the best midlife crisis simulator ever made. The arcade versions of Turbo Outrun and Outrunners are both worth checking out. As is the tribute game Final Freeway 2R, which I've never heard of, so I may have to track that down sometime. Lotus 2, which is also known as Lotus 1 on the Genesis. If we're talking old-style racing games where you're on more of a traditional track, this one is great. It's a very difficult game, but that's part of the charm. The computer editions also feature link cable play for up to 4 players. Then, if you have an SNES, Top Gear 2 also is worth a look. It's a spiritual successor to the Lotus series, so thanks for that information. Didn't know that. Domark's F1 on the Genesis. If you want an old school race that feels more like a real race, this is it. Extremely fast IndyCar racing with vicious rival cars. It's a thrill that many other racing games fail to capture. And if you want to get less traditional, I have to recommend Speed Buggy, or the spiritual sequel to the 2600's Enduro, which was called the Great American Cross Country Road Race. That's a mouthful. Yes, it is. Both of those are top-notch in my opinion, and I'm not familiar with either of those, so I may have to look at that. And there are many more worth playing in 2015. For example, consider Final Lap Twin, which is a racing RPG. Yes! Anyway, part of the charm of these old games for me is the exaggerated sensation of speed they create by using scenery that doesn't adhere to real 3D geometry. What I also find charming is how much the games boil down to dodging cars that are coming down the screen at you, not too dissimilarly from the missiles in Galaga. That's why I call them Dodge the Blob Racers, because the cars might as well be anything. Well, that's one way to look at it. But if you're after a simulation and realism, many serious car simulations were made before Gran Turismo. Your listeners may want to check out Revs from 1984, Indianapolis 500, the simulation, Microprose's World Circuit, and there are many others as well. True, they weren't generally found on consoles or in the arcades, but in the worlds of introduction to Mark of the Wolves, certainly they exist. In the words, I'm sorry, not worlds. Now getting back to the 7800 Pole Position. I think there are a few things that made it less than stellar port. The thing that sticks out most for me isn't just the animation is choppy, but there's only so many side-to-side positions your car can be in. That is, as you steer, your car doesn't smoothly slide from side to side, but rather makes pretty big hops. This is true. This makes the game needlessly painful to play, especially when avoiding tight formations of opposing cars. I still think it's fun to try and beat your score over and over, but if listeners are after a better Pole Position clone, I'd recommend the Master System's World Grand Prix instead. It's fast, smooth, and fun. It not only has a multitude of tracks, but you can also create your own in a track editor. By the way, you've inspired me to start up my 7800 collection again. All right. As both an Atari fan and a retro racing aficionado, I had to snag Motor Psycho, which I'm very excited about as it looks great. Rolling hills and the ability to jump over motorists? Yes, please. Robotron and Mario Brothers are on their way as well. Lewis. And then he said at the end of the episode, Pole Position, you mentioned games you'd be covering and whether we thought they were trash, meh, solid, Hall of Fame. And here's my take on some of the games listed. Don't know if this is the right place to send them or if there's a forum or if this is too early. Before the podcast that features these games, let me know if you'd prefer to post them elsewhere. No, what you did is fine. And so what he did was he gave me a whole bunch of games and I'm going to read the ones that are covered today. So Xevious, he gave his opinion on that. He also gave his opinion on Ball Blazer, Karateka and Choplifter, and I'll read those when I get to that. So this is perfectly fine, Lewis. Thank you. Xevious, I think it's somewhere between solid and Hall of Fame. The expert mode is enough to push it past other ports for me. I love that it's closer to the arcade's vertical aspect ratio, and it pushes lots of enemies and shots on screen without flicker, especially in expert. Yeah, I didn't really notice any flicker. This is one of the 7800's greatest strengths over other systems at the time, and I wish it had more games which took advantage of it. In my opinion, it's easily better than the NES release, which didn't even bother to do the stage bosses correctly. So, very interesting there. And I will say this, when I played the NES version, I was able to defeat the mothership a lot easier. So take that for what it's worth. I also got an email from Stitcher telling me that I'm on Stitcher now. So yep, you can find me on Stitcher. I applied and they said, you're good to go. Richard wrote in about Robotron. He said he definitely had this game for the 7800, but I don't remember liking it that much. At the time, I don't think I knew you could play with both joysticks. Either I didn't read the instructions or I never bothered to try it. I never played the arcade game, so I didn't know that the game had two joysticks. I was 10 at the time, so some slack would be nice. Well, I'll give it to you. Of course, a game like this and its spiritual equal, Smash TV, a personal favorite of mine, I played a lot on the Midway arcade compilations on the newer systems, is a lot easier with dual analog joysticks. Totally agree. Then I heard from Bill. He says, hey, Phil. Hey, Bill. I'm a happy owner of a 7800, which I admit I mostly use as my main Atari 2600 console. My family's original wood grain one only coming out for annual Atari party events that I throw. I received it along with a ton of 2600 and 7800 games, most in the boxes with manuals, which is pretty rare to get them like that. Well, the 7800, it seems more common, but not the 2600. From a coworker as a going away gift. It was a mobile game company, but I was still the biggest Atari nerd there, even compared to the guy who used to work at Atari. That's really cool. I was the kind of kid that would go up to strangers and say, hey, mister, do you like Atari? Oh, my. However, my history with the 7800 hasn't always been great. I actually had one about a decade prior to receiving this one, in the late 1990s when I was in college. I was living off in another city, my 2600 back at home with my parents, though my Atari 8-bit computer came with me and got heavy use. I ended up getting a 7800 somehow, and I really didn't like it, and it was all Galaga's fault. Wow. You see, I had what I considered an excellent Galaga port on my NES. I also had a local arcade where I'd hit two games regularly. Tekken 2, the fighting game I had some friends who would come up from my hometown to play, and my button mashing of martial law was almost good enough to beat my friends at Marianne's expert ability to pull reversal moves, and Galaga, the game I knew and loved from my early childhood. I played it while my mom checked out at the local Safeway. Between the 7800's controller, which is a pro at hurting your wrist, I agree, 7800 Galaga being not clearly close enough to the arcade to suit my taste, my lack of any other compelling 7800 cards, and the fact that I picked up a 2600 Junior, I decided to pass it along to someone else. Or maybe I just gave it back to my friend. Smile face. By the way, an interesting thing I noticed during my arcade outings. If I stunk at one game and I was great at the other, and vice versa. In other words, I would never hit the arcade and be able to do well at both. Well, I guess this was my Galaga weekend. So interesting there. And that was from Bill, and it says, sent from my computer. I dig that. I got an email from Ferg, so let's see what Ferg has to say in this text edition of the Ferg Files. Hi, Phil. I hope that I made it in time to be on the show. You did. The show is actually might be released a little later. We'll see. I enjoyed the last show, as always. I missed her. You tried. He does appreciate my time to take to talk a bit about the arcade's company history if you're doing an arcade port. I'm too lazy to do that. And every time he says do, he puts the word Mr. in front of it very nicely. Oh man, you almost got me. I'm tired. I will start with Xevious. I don't recall ever playing this in the arcades, but I could be wrong about that. I think they did a great job porting it to 7800. It looks really good. The sound is actually exceptional. I can't be the only one who thinks of Starcade while playing Xevious. I forgot to mention that. Yeah, they used some music from Xevious and Starcade. The best thing about this game, of course, is being able to use two buttons for the laser and the bombs. I just did Super Cobra for the 2600 on my show. And with one button on the joystick, you alternate between lasers and bombs every time and you press the button. That stinks in my opinion. In Xevious, I discovered that you could hold down the lasers. Are they lasers? I didn't really read the manual. No, it's a zapper. Get it right. And then press the bomb whenever. This move works great on my Ed Ladin 4A joystick and a Genesis controller. Not so much on the Crampline joystick. Having heaped all this praise on Xevious, this is meh for me. I just don't care for vertical shooters for some reason. I give Vanguard a pass, though, because It is both. So yeah, Vanguard, if you don't know, is both vertical and horizontal, and it's on the 2600. Robotron 2084 is probably in my top 10 arcade game list. Uh-oh. Let's see what he thinks about this port. There are some good home ports, like this one, okay. But in my opinion, any good port is rendered moot unless somehow you can play with two joysticks. Yeah, I can understand that. Using a stick and a button is not going to cut it for this game. You can you can do this on the 7800 every time he writes the word do. That's great. But as far as I know, there is no joystick coupler for the stock joysticks, but I wouldn't want to use one anyways. What I did was I plugged my Ed Ladin controller in the right port and the Genesis controller in the left, and I held my Jenny controller against the Ed Ladin stick the best I could, firing with that and moving with the Ed Ladin stick. It actually worked pretty good, except the Jenny D-pad is on a slight angle and would slip sometimes, and I would end up shooting diagonally when I didn't want to. The game looks really good, and amazingly, there isn't any slowdown with all those moving characters on the screen. If this was an NES game, it would be horrible. The sound, however, is atrocious. I love the sound in Williams arcade games, and they did an okay job on Joust on 7800, but this one is bad. Despite this, Robotron 2084 is a solid game for me. Thanks for giving me a little part of your show, Phil. Talk to you soon, Ferg, the host of the Atari 2600 Game by Game podcast, which you should listen to after this. Thanks, Ferg. Yeah, you know, I have the same 4.8 joystick, and what I did something similar. I think I traded hands, though. I think one time I tried to control it, the guns with the Genesis controller and steer my guy with the joystick, and then I switched it around. But when I held the Genesis pad, I didn't put it down. I actually held it in my hand with my thumb over it. You could almost cut the Genesis controller in half and do that. I used the 6-button one. I don't know if that D-pad makes a difference, but it worked out much better. Not as good as if you had like a dual joystick where you didn't have to finagle it, but that was pretty good. All right, that was Ferg. Now it's time for everyone's favorite part, Shinto. Let's see what Shinto has to say in today's edition of Shinto Says.
I used to be an actor, mostly when I was a kid. Now, you probably haven't seen me in anything. I didn't say I was a good actor. But I remember going to a rap party for some production or another, which took over a local pizza parlor. Now, in the 80s, any pizza joint worth its sauce had some arcade games. And this particular one, I remember, had a Centipede, Asteroids Deluxe, Space Invaders, Berserk, and Robotron 2084. I don't know what that says about me, that I remember the arcade games, but not the specific production I was in. I fished a quarter out of my pocket and sauntered up to the Robotron cabinet, convinced that I would do well because I played this game on my Atari 7800, and I could get it to, like, level 15. The first thing that struck me as odd as I stood in front of the cabinet was that there are no buttons, just two joysticks, one for aiming and one for firing. That threw me off. The zoom-in screen to start a level and the sound effects were slightly different, so that threw me off. And there may have been someone looking over my shoulder. So, yeah, all told, it was not my best game, and I barely made it to level 2 alive. It's certainly not beyond that. I eventually came to love twin-stick shooters. It's one of my favorite genres, and I wondered how I ever lived with the single-stick and button configuration on Robotron for the 7800, and the Lynx version, too, for that matter. It was only recently, say 5 or 6 years ago, that I learned 7800 Robotron supports two sticks, and if you can find a way to secure the controllers, that's totally the way to go. I use a pair of SpectraVideo QuickShot controllers, which have suction cups on the bottom. It works okay as long as you go easy on them. The old suction cups tend to pop loose without too much effort. I was looking at that Ed Ladin Super Twin 78, and while I can't personally justify the cost, I imagine that would play a mean game of Robotron. The old high score binder's top recorded score for this game was 799,325 points, set by my brother on March 28th, 1991, on the novice skill level. I'm going to give Robotron a rating of solid. It's a fantastic game, and the 7800 version certainly does it justice. It's fast and has no trace of flicker, and I think it's the sort of game that you could do on the 7800 but could not do on the NES. Back in episode 1, I said I was going to withhold my Atari 7800 origin story for the Xevious episode, and, well, here we are. I came home from Boy Scout camp, I think it was, and my brother was sitting in front of his little 5-inch black-and-white TV doing something. I walked over for a closer look and saw what looked like a video game on his TV, but it was not like any video game I'd seen before. The first thing I noticed was a great amount of detail in the graphics, you know, grayscale as they were on this TV. And the other thing was that much of the screen was left blank, which I didn't understand. On a 5-inch TV, that leaves very little to work with, but my brother was working with it, focused and intense. He explained the game to me like this. You move your ship around and you shoot targets in the air with a left button, and when the targeting sight in front disappears, remember, black and white TV can't show red, you can drop a bomb and blow up stuff on the ground with the right button. He died and went back to the title screen. As I was trying to decipher what exactly was written on that screen at the top, it hit me that our Atari can't do stuff like this. He told me it's a whole new system and pointed off to the left where a large box lay open on his bed. The box said Atari 7800 Video Game System, and at his feet, laying on the carpet and hurriedly cabled up to his TV, was this sleek black and silver console. I was gone over his birthday, you see, and this was his birthday present, the console in Xevious. I didn't even know the 7800 existed. This was all new to me. My brother generously handed me the controller so that I could have a turn, and all my ships unceremoniously exploded in relatively quick succession, but it was still fresh and exciting and unbelievably advanced. The Atari 7800 Pro System. And Xevious was sort of its ambassador. Eventually, we hooked it up to the color TV, and that made it look even better. What I like best about Xevious is that you keep encountering new things the farther you get. You know, the field of indestructible panels, the eagle landing strip, the tanks in the water, those weird pyramid things that hang around your ship for a little while before zooming off. All that stuff was surprising when we first got that far. In the high score binder, my brother's score of 220,180 points, set June 2nd, 1990 on the novice skill level, has a little letter F next to it, indicating that he finished the game. Xevious seems to go on forever, but from what I read about the arcade version, there are 16 different sections, and once you get past 16, it wraps around to 7. I just learned about that, so for the past 25 years, I always thought my brother was lying about getting to the point where it wraps around, because I expected it to, you know, start over from the beginning, just harder, like every other Atari game, so I didn't believe him when he said it wrapped around. But I guess it did. I've never gotten that far personally, and I probably owe him an apology. Probably. Xevious for me gets a solid rating. It's a game that I love and try to play whenever I see it in an arcade. The only version of this game I actually own is a 7800 version, but I keep very nearly buying one of the many Namco collections, which includes Xevious. My best friend back then had Xevious on his NES, but I think the 7800 port is better. So yeah, this and Robotron, these two were very, very solid, and if my Hall of Fame could hold 8 titles, these would be in there along with Joust and 2 games that we haven't talked about yet. Still, they're fantastic games and absolutely reasons to own a 7800. They're great arcade ports, especially if you're a little faster than I was in discovering Robotron had a dual stick mode.
Thank you, as always, Shinto. Man, he has some good stories to tell, and I'm so glad that he shares them here with us, especially about the 7800. That's what I really want to hear, is about any stories that people have about the 7800 growing up, because it was rare. Not too many people had one, so I can't imagine what it was like to be a little brother to come home and see my brother with a 7800. And yeah, that was a sleek and it was a nice looking system. It still is. I think it's one of the systems that's held up better over time than just about any other of the systems from that era. But yeah, Shinto, I totally appreciate it, and go apologize to your brother. But I want to thank you too, because yeah, I think I forgot to mention that once you get past the 16th screen, which you can't tell unless you really know what you're looking at, because there's no division lines, you wrap back around to 7, and it just keeps going on and on. So I guess in a way you can kind of beat it, even though you don't really beat it. So yeah, very cool there. All right, guys, I'm tired. I won't joke with you. I'm really tired. I apologize for any mistakes I made today, but I thank you guys very much for giving me a little part of your time today. And today only, I also want to thank Kurt and Sarah. Don't forget, you can listen to me on iTunes, on Stitcher, and I also stream the show on YouTube if you want to put it on in the background or something. I throw a few pictures in there, nothing too special, but it is on YouTube as well. You can also follow me on YouTube as the No Swear Gamer. I review all sorts of games. I'm now at over 140 episodes there, so there should be something there that you'd like. I just got an unboxing video. I bought these 2600 games that were all uncommons, and that's right up my alley. Really liked that and did some reviews as well, including a couple of football games, Real Sports Football on the 2600, which will be on Ferg's show soon, and also Joe Montana's Football for the Sega Genesis, which has a really interesting backstory that involves John Madden. You should check that out as well. And I also did a review of Seahawk. You want to talk about a game where one button tries to do two things at the same time? You should watch that review of Seahawk for the 2600. Thank you, Frogo and Panda and whoever else made that. All right, guys, I think I remembered everything. If you would, share the show. Leave a five-star review. I'm not saying the show's worth five stars. I'm just saying I'm trying to get word out. And supposedly five-star reviews help get word out. It helps it hit up the charts. And I just want to get everyone's story about the 7800 while the show's on. The show won't be going on forever ever because the library's just not that big. But get your stories in. You can send them into Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. Atari7800podcast@AOL.com. Next episode is going to cover Desert Falcon and Ball Blazer, followed by Choplifter and Karateka or Teka in episode 10. And episode 11 is going to be the Froggo Games, Tink Command, and Water Ski. So should be some interesting times there. And finally, we're going to get full color cartridges. Yay. All right, guys. Thank you again for giving me a little part of your day. Remember, guys, games are fun, but always keep first things first. I will catch you all later. I'm going to bed. Good night.
You have been listening to the Atari 7800 Game by Game podcast. But you already knew that, didn't you? The Atari 7800 Game by Game podcast is part of the Retro Junkies Network. Blah blah blah, copyright 2015 blah blah blah. I really need to find a better job. I wonder if Ferg is hiring.
So finally, Phil, you listen to me, mister.